Good morning, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, our media fraternity, and welcome to the auditorium of the Institute for Democratic Governance, IDEC, where we're gathered this morning for the press conference. This is an IDEC CFI press conference and has as the theme, Ghana needs trustworthy and long-lasting voters renaissance. Ghana needs trustworthy and long-lasting voters renaissance. My name is Patrick Bokai, and I believe that by God's divine grace and gift of another day, it is always very proper that we invite his presence to steer the affairs of this program to a fruitful and successful end. And I would therefore like to invite a member of the CFI steering committee who is representing the MACCC and who is a senior pastor at the Covenant Public Community Chapel East and Champions to lead us in the opening of prayer. Please help welcome Reverend Emmanuel Manson.
Father, we thank you for today, brightly, lovely, and most gracious. We have come to deliberate on the future of our nation that we respect our election processes. We go more important than we must be in wisdom. Pray the Lord, we shall be good. Pray my truth, send us forward. The extent that this nation will progress peacefully. Pray that all ideas that we need to bring for change. Pray that as we even finish the dissemination of this information, we also receive that we understand the conservation of the breadth of this nation. We pray that this meeting can be fruitful, successful, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much for joining us. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I always believe that my last occasion line is it's always proper to have a chair. And my chair this morning is someone who needs to elaborate an introduction. He's actually the U.S. Embassy Martin Luther King Jr. Award winner for 360, and he's also the executive director of the Institute for Democratic Governance. Can you please help me welcome to give us a pep up from our meeting today, Dr. Emmanuel Chesney.
Welcome to IPEC, the Institute for Democratic Governance, and welcome also to the Civic Forum Initiative. The Civic Forum Initiative Secretariat is here, so when you come here, you come to two organizations. I know that sometimes you come to the different, but once the entity introduces people on the IPEC, you see that. This is not an island, sole island, it's an island in the Civic Forum Initiative. We are happy you all turned out to be your members, and it's all about our nation and what contributions we all could make as citizens to find solutions to problems that we think we must tackle with a lot of understanding and with a lot of commitment to the peace and stability of our country and to the strengthening of our democracy. So we brought you here this morning just to present a statement that the Civic Forum Initiative Steering Group has been working on for some time now. It's a statement on what we think ought to be done in order to begin tackling the voters register issue. I think the statement itself is predictive, so I cannot go into the details as the chairman of the Civic Forum Institute and chairman. So it's, I'm truly delighted that you come. We hope we are going to engage you more often as we also see as civic society actors to get involved in some of the debates that usually or too soon and too quickly turn into a partisan exchange. I think citizens must have a voice, a clear voice, and not just define what we consider to be the interest of all, the national interest. So thank you very much for the opportunity for coming to us. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Dr. We will now move on to the next item of the program, which is the presentation of statements. But before that, I would like to acknowledge the presence of some of the members on the high table. And so I'd like to start with our personality who's been joining us. We have Ahmad Mahan Gadol, who is representing the Muslim the National Team. Please, a round of applause for him. Next to Ahmad Mahan Gadol is Apostle Samuel Yao Yuxi, who represents the GPC. The steering committee of the CMO. Next apostle is the personality who will be presenting the statement. I'll come to him later on, but we also have from the chair, Dr. Emmanuel Chesney, who is executive director of the Institute for Democratic Governance. And then of course on the CMO. Round of applause. We have next to Dr. Manuel Pete, Yes, the Percy Jonah. This Percy Jonah is a senior research fellow of the Institute of Democratic Governance and former head of the Political Science Department of the University of Ghana. Last but not least, it's a verbal introduction because I already introduced it as a person who did the opening for that. And he's none other than the Reverend Emmanuel Hansen, Reverend MACCC, and a member of the Spirit of Prophecy. You're all very welcome. So we have we've come to the crucial part of our program today, which is the presentation of statements. And to do this is the incumbent chair of the Civic Forum Initiative. He is also a senior officer, a retired senior officer of the Ghana Armed Forces. And I'd like you to help me welcome Major General Lee Khan Kobe.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We were really in the right of the reason for campaigning here. So without any more time, let me present to you our statement as started by the Civic Forum Initiative. Thank you all for honoring our joint invitation. The Institute of Democratic Governance, the Civic Forum Initiative, have invited you to a discussion on the best way to resolve the ongoing controversies over the 2012 parliamentary quota range. I think it is in the best interest of the nation to resolve the issues dispassionately and in an excellent manner as the 2016 presidential and parliamentary elections are fast approaching. It is our belief that our beloved country is a trustworthy and lasting protest register, not only for the 2016 elections, but also for all elections thereafter. It's also our view that the nation currently lacks such a register, getting from the current disagreement in the 2012 parliamentary protest register, especially between the two major political parties that dominate Ghana. The records show that since 1992, there has been no presidential and parliamentary elections without one controversy or the other arising over the integrity of the National Voters Register. Controversy is often stirred by a recurring fabricating allegation by one of the two dominant political parties that the voters register for any forthcoming presidential and parliamentary elections is closed in favor of its opponent. The National Democratic Congress did so in 2008. The New Patriotic Party is doing so now. In 2012, they appear to have been no disagreement that the 2008 protest register was voted and needed replacement. So the political parties especially collaborated with the Electoral Commission in producing the 2012 parliamentary voters register. Contrary to the general expectation that going parliamentary would cure the problems of voters' voters register and so on, it has become increasingly clear that the parliamentary voters register, which was produced at a cost of 297 million Ghana cedis less than 4 years ago, failed to do so. Over the years, tens and hundreds of billions of taxpayers' money and intent on this apparent way of fixing the problem of voters' rights ahead of imminent election. But increasingly, it has dawned on us that such solutions are essentially one election annual. Their good effects have not been felt or lasted beyond the specific election which they have been given to apply. This process is currently unfolding ahead of the 2016 elections as a new patriotic party in the National Democratic Congress. I'm currently arguing about the credibility of the voters' rights, but we are working to be done or not done to solve the problems that they see in the race. As we are all aware, disputes over the voters' rights tend to travel through the entire electoral process. As we are all aware, disputes over the voters' rights tend to travel through the entire electoral process. And public opinion on the option of coping to fixing the credibility problems of the 2012 amendment to voters' rights. But as the political, has raised the political temperature of the country, already those who share the view that the new voters' rights is needed. Which been branded as supporters of the new patriotic party, while those who prefer that the existing register is reviewed and upgraded will swiftly be seen as supporters of the NDC. If the care is not taken, this politicization of a world trigger is the poorly informed and premature decision that may sustain shortly political control, but not necessarily and your resolutions that advance the national agenda. As observers, as observed earlier, the past solutions to the credibility problems of the voters' rights have invariably turned out to be one election fix. It is not the national interest that we as a nation have failed to produce a trusted and enduring legacy whose maintenance or reform is also cost and expenditure. It is in the national interest to break a cycle of one election fixing of the credibility problem of our voters' rights. To do so, we must adopt sound, practical, and lasting solutions to the problems of the existing voters' rights. The truth is that neither the claim by the New Patriotic Party nor the counterclaims of the National Democratic Congress provide a sufficient and sound basis for making such decisions. The allegations and counterclaims are yet to be substantiated, therefore do not provide the sound basis required for making a clear interpretation of the best way to secure the voters' rights to the most credible the Institute of Democratic Governance and the Civil Forum Initiative are how they feel that it is in the vital interest of the nation that the voters' rights is made and seen in a genuine instrument of fairness and equal opportunity to all political parties and contestants in the forthcoming elections. The way forward is for the Electoral Commission to task a committee of experienced and reputable experts to scientifically and impartially assess the accuracy of the existing voters' rights. The committee should also verify the counterclaims and report on the overall health and suitability of the existing voters' rights for the 2016 election. It's only on the basis of an objective and transparent assessment of the set page that the EC and the nation will be better informed to make the hard choices needed to secure a credible voters' rights, not only for the 2016 election, but also for the future election. Accordingly, we We call on the Electoral Commission to independently set up an impartial panel made up of eminent experts and individuals with experience and knowledge of issues and a compilation of credible witness experts. The task force will undertake a critical assessment of the 2012 biometric voter register and dispassionately propose solutions to identify and or persistent problems which undermine the public trust and confidence in the integrity of the register. We believe that the committee's report will enhance the processes of consultations and deliberation, which the Electoral Commission has already initiated, in order to make the best decision for the nation, giving Ghana a more trusted and lasting register.
Thank you very much. That was the presentation of the statement by the chairman of the State Board of Missions, Major General Lee Khan, for the time. I believe that we are nearing the completion of this press conference, but we cannot come to an end without giving our media persons the opportunity to ask questions to our resource person on my team. Before we do that, I would like to acknowledge the presence of another member of the steering committee for the Civic Forum Initiative, and he is the person of Mr. Seth Abloso, who is representing the Trade Union Conference. You're welcome, sir. Let me also avail myself of this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of the media houses that are here for this press conference. For television, we invite GTV News. We'd like to see if you're here. GTV News, yes. GTV Government Channel, Multi TV, Metro Television, TV Africa, TV3, Vassal One, TV, New TV, Radio, we have GBC Radio News, City FM, John News, Star FM, Peace FM. For the print media, the Daily Graphic, the Ghanaian Times, Daily Guide, the Chronicle. For online, we have the Uber. And let me also say that iGhana is streaming this event live on the internet. They have about 70,000 plus subscribers. And so we also live on the internet. And then we have Ghana News Agency. I also understand that the Ghana Business News is here. If I haven't acknowledged any media powers here, I'd like to say that they're very welcome and because of the program I am doing so. Without further ado, I'd like to call those of you who like to ask us at staff for purposes of the cameras benefited from your questions and for clarity. We would like you to come to the lectern, take the microphone, and then ask your questions. And then we will pass the microphone to our resource persons to respond. So, yes, you just raise your hand and we'll invite you over. Take the questions. Please mention your name and which media house you belong to when you take the microphone. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Simon Abdul, and I'm the director of the business. The first thing is committees is set to look at the very serious national issues. And at the end of the day, the results have been accomplished. And then that has degenerated into distrust. Where we are today, calling for yet another committee to be set up by the Electoral Commission, which we all know some of the opposition parties will address because then the way government can appoint the commissioner, there is suspicion that they always appoint their favorites from the commission. So if another politician is said, aren't we going to repeat the same thing of trust and probably not publish or not publishing the eventual findings of the session? In which case, we are not finding it's always rather very contested with a very important conclusion around the process of the
I think we can take another question before we ask our listeners to respond. Please come in. Okay.
Thank you. I'm going to say, almost all the government president countries, particularly with the government party, not very well that we find the commitment to be sent. Probably will be good for those positions as well. Thank you very much.
And then we shall pause here for our research questions. Okay. Yes, it's a third question. So we can take you back to time. Any more questions from our media questions? We would like you to ask questions so you can understand what this is all about and that we can actually report some accurate things about the main questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My friend, to summarize the best of questions, you seem to be saying that there are no dynamics who do not belong to one side or the other. We are polarized and split, and it will be difficult to find dynamics who rise above and divide. Wow, what a cynical view. I still think that a good number of dynamics want to see a multi-party. Those are system strengthening. We think our parties have contributed to strengthening our democracy in a way, stabilizing it. But they also want to see our parties doing a good job for Ghana. And really have not taken sides in the polarization. But they see a party that has elected to government and they want it to be governing well. So if you take the membership of the parties, I don't know now because, for instance, NDC is re-registering its membership. But in the data we have, for instance, early this year, or last year when we were doing a multi-party governance report, they both said they had about 3 million people. Okay? So if you add their membership, total membership, we are talking about 6 million. And the population of Ghana is bigger than that. We are 25 million. So, first of all, I think we should disabuse our minds that we are so polarized in our country that you cannot find people with neutral voices. And the way you put it, it makes me feel like I belong to both parties, one or the other. But you know my stand. I support the parties, but I don't belong to any of them. But I like seeing them working well for Ghana and the important improvements against them. Not only the two parties, all the parties. So from that point of view, the idea the steering group have in calling for a task force, okay, with the expertise. You know, the debates on the issues, arguments that have been raised about the existing register has to do with data, okay? It has to do with photographs and names appearing twice, border crossing, and so on and so forth. And these are things that are technical. In the minds of the steering group, our politicians are discussing it already, beginning views. Okay? But some things, there are experts, because they're technical, to go in to sort out the veracity. And I believe that there are many experts in our country who have the competence. There are many even politicians who are now raising to what they describe as statesmen, who think Ghana first, they want to see the problem solved, because we all want peace and stability. So first of all, I don't agree with you that it would be difficult to find people to do an honest, professional, and impartial. And I believe you are doing impartial journalism. Or have you been caught by, or bitten by the bar? Okay, then you have to identify your parties. Which party do you belong to? And you said, okay, so we can find people to do this. But you also raised an important question. What would be, maybe I should explain the rationale of needing an independent group. Already, the parties made their case and they are preferring solutions. But you see, public policy decisions are not made that way. Once an allegation is made, it ought to be investigated thoroughly by people trained to do those kinds of investigations or assessments. And when they confirm that what has been said is true or not, that determines the measures to be taken, the decisions to be taken, the actions to be taken, the resources to be committed to solving the problem. We haven't done that. And already we are preferring solutions to the problem. If we don't get the scientific way of establishing the evidence for a decision, we might end up investing our resources on things that we were saying are going to be the problems. So you need an impartial investigation, and the Electoral Commission is the only state institution with the mandate and authority to put such a body together to do that. Now, the second point is that to avoid the bickering, and I hope you saw the MPP press statement on the 18th of August, and then you also saw the NDC's statement responding or reacting to some of the things the MPP has said. Can you imagine going to an IPAC meeting with the two statements on the table? It is important that the dialogue, the deliberations are facilitated by a report of a technical group, impartial, not with the parties. In fact, the fact that you come from a party does not mean you cannot do a professional thing. But it's, people should see you as having the credibility and the capacity to do that. It is not a bad thing to belong to a party, but you should also rise above that to serve the national interest. It is rabid, you know, partisanship that is the problem. And usually it's not everybody in the party that has that. We have groups we call extremists who tend to be, you know, the fervor, the passion, they're so passionate about the party, they don't see things the way everybody does. It's massive for the party. But we also have people in the party who think, okay, the national issue. That's why they are even in parties. So we are hoping that once the task force is set up and their report would enable the Electoral Commission to make a more informed decision and therefore use that report also to steer the conversations. You know, the EC has already taken the initiative on consultation with invited civil society groups and parties to make submissions. But we've studied the situation, we monitored the debate, saying the EC made that decision. And the issues are still going on, and we're getting polarized between new register or no new register or old register. But we do not know the truth in the allegations that both sides are making, or the claims that both sides are making. It is for the Commission to sort that out. So we believe that it will not be a white elephant report not used, because it is going to hold consultation. In fact, the text is going to do a workshop and it has important decisions to make. So we are very confident that if a good report is on the table, the Electoral Commission will act in the next many years, and I think that is their commitment. So I've answered the two questions, haven't I? The third one is not for me. I don't know who you guys, so I don't know.
Sorry, Mr. Thomas.
Okay, we have addressed it. The CFI steering group did not feel that we know enough to get into the issues, the details. That's why we want investigation, a committee, a task force, to go in there with the data they have. Probably they are even going to work not only in Ghana, three countries were mentioned, Burkina Faso, and others. They'll go there and be able to talk to them based on the mandate that has been given to them. We don't know how the EC is going to go about it, but the EC has enough authority to decide on how it wants to do this, if it so decides. And I think we should wait for a group to come up who we do not see immediately as having partisan interests, and therefore, when they say something, you are not sure whether it is objective or it is just time to gain advantage. We don't know that. Let that independent group unearth the truth, give us the facts, and then we can engage in the debate. So we do not indulge in the details and who said it or what. We think that is best done by dispatching it by experts and people with experience to present such a report after they've done the assessment. Thank you. Yes, you have more than that been said. Currently, the EC has called for the parties to bring in their claims immediately. Now, who is going to take a decision? That is where our suggestion is coming. Let's have a committee of technical experts who will do a job and come up with findings we discussed nationally and other things. So that as of now, we've taken it at least working on it, and that's why we feel that the people who are responsible, especially the people, will come up with all the, to investigate all the things, and then we'll come up with it.
Thank you very much, Professor Linky and Dr. Kutler. I think it's good that we got to answer. Okay, so
the first question is that committees are not trusted, their reports are not published, and so on and so forth. As a matter of fact, a certain part of committees, especially as always in the way the recent complaint is made. In November 2008, there was a complaint from the APC, which at that time was a position, about the voting register in two Ashanti constituencies. Nobody knows what happened to that. There was a number of first voters, all of a sudden, problem in those two constituencies. How was it resolved? We went to another committee, a committee for people who voted. IT knowledge was formed. The NPD got on with that, the NPC got on with that. The IT department of the ECB said, but one person. And somebody came from the African Science Council, who also has a track record, and people want to meet them. The problem was resolved to the satisfaction of the very party that made the relationship with the two, they say that the set of authority and the request for public, no action is taken. I have stood on three different countries for this. The one, Roba, the Constitution People's Amendment Act. The committee that showed how it could be implemented, really. It's not as if we went, but was not complete as well. So we did everything the law that passed. The only thing is, the start of the law is the CIP, but the EC is free to implement it, what it considers to be
right.
So if the EC should decide to pay, the law is there. Empowered it to be met if it can do it. I also said, well, currently, the EC has got very bad in implementing the Electoral Reform Commission. The only reason why it follows back to the beginning is a two-week extension is that they have categorized themselves in three. Those that are beyond this, only government and public category. Those that are within the capacity of the ECDC without any oppressive impact, and those on the ECDC's further confirmation. Right now, what we are working on are those that the ECDC's further confirmation on. The electoral reform report, the recommendations, are not abandoned. So there is absolutely no reason to suggest that the committee set up by the ECDC are ignored. Now, on the foreign nationals on the register, the only reason why probably we do not make any consent comment is that this is the allegation that has been made. And this is the very allegation that is a technical task was an effect. So there's nothing for us to say we support, we don't support, and so on and so on. The technical task force will be fancy.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I think we'd like to take a few more questions from this amendment. Your name and your decision. My name is Josette. My name is Josette.
Hello.
Can
you talk
questions before we bring the questions to this conclusion. Any more questions? All suggestions or contributions? Suggestions, contributions, comments, remarks? Well, in the absence of we'll call on the Mr. General Chairman for the CFM.
Well, this is a specific question. I'd like to be to our people.
So, national politics
and never done in a back. We need facts. And to arrive at the fact, we must do a proper study. That's why we have said that the issues have been thrown out. There are disagreements about what the issues are. So we want a neutral adjudicator to look at the facts as presented by both sides. And everyone, and to advise or to come up with a report that will form the basis for our forward. Okay. We cannot be prescriptive as to who should form the committee. We are only suggesting that in forming a community. Because what had been put out by one side needs technical expertise. So we have to go into it to say whether it is true or not. So we at this point say set up that thing. Once we know the truth, and then move forward. That is when the house, all the other stakeholders, I have. Of course, we are not. That's not the end for us. We want to do the proof. Then we can take on the other.
Thank you very much.
Questions have been answered already, and we realize that the statement we gave to you, and you probably observed that when General was reading the last sentence on the first page, I think in putting it on the letter, some part of it came up. Okay, so it ends with the entire electoral, it starts with public opinion on your page. There's a whole sentence that has gone up. Because he was going to say that through the entire electoral process, in the travel through the electoral, with dire consequences. Okay, with dire consequences. And maybe the best thing to do is we would immediately put the corrected version on the net, on our website, so you can pick it up. Or we can also send it to you, since we have your addresses. So that's all I wanted to explain. And in fact, it takes account of why we think an impartial task force might be appointed. Because you know, there are cases that come in from two parties that are contesting presidential parliamentary elections. And it's a different kind of policy. Okay. Thank you.
Is it possible to have
a different if it, we want to wait just for a few minutes to get the corrected page. To get the corrected page. Or you have enough. It doesn't matter. Okay. That's what I thought. We will just send it to them. Yes, for their reference. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, as it's being said, if you can wait for a few minutes.
Also, like the way
you
get it to
be. Yes. We'll send
by the time you finish your refreshment, we'll have it to be back. Okay. Thank you. So we might be
clear. I think that some of the reasons there's a question and that's the focus question. Well, you have no question. We'll look at questions and get some of the sequence. We have soon come to the end of our press conference. Before we conclude the closing prayer, I'd also like to acknowledge the presence of Mr. Kofi Nantichi, who was the former boss and authority of the center. Thank you very much for your presence.